So let's get into the CNS, the central nervous system. That's your brain and your spinal cord. Your brain and your spinal cord are your central processing unit. Now, I've grayed out some stuff because I don't have time to talk about everything I want to talk about that's germane to your test, so I want to get focused in and be appreciative of your time and your attendance and your attention. So there's a hindbrain. Well, all animals that we know of, think a lizard's got a hindbrain, right? Bird's got a hindbrain, dolphin got a hindbrain, monkey got a hindbrain, human got a hindbrain, right? It's your basic level of survival, right? You got your cerebellum, your medulla, your pons. You get knocked back here in the hindbrain hard enough, you die. Because those functions are parasympathetic and they're controlled by those structures in your heart and your hind brain. Those are absolutely crucial to functioning physically. You lose those, you go into coma, right? You become unresponsive. If it's damage is extensive enough, you die. Midbrain. So we got a small area that deals with dopamine regulation and voluntary muscle control, and that's a little bit more advanced. Not every little creature got a midbrain. Worm. Every little creature, think about it in terms of other species. What do they got that we don't got? Or more properly, what do we got that they don't got? We got forebrain like nobody's business. We got proportionally more forebrain than every other species. Not in terms of mass, in terms of ratio, right? Whales got a bigger head than human, right? Got a bigger brain, but proportionally, we got way more forebrain. Forebrain seems to be what makes us particularly human. That makes us really adaptive. If you go back to the functionalist school, y'all remember that, right? Should remember that for your test. Anybody know what name associated with functionalism? William James, that's it. There you go. Hallelujah. Can I get an amen? Yes. Forebrain seems to make us more functional than all other species. Why doesn't monkey rule the world like Planet of the Apes? Because monkey hasn't got as much forebrain as we do. We're smarter than monkey in different ways. We have abstract thinking, and monkey we don't think has that much abstract thinking. So now we're talking about a large section with many parts generating what we consider as human beings to be higher functions. That isn't to say we're better creatures than monkey, because some people would debate that all creatures are equally valuable in the scheme of things. Others would say, no, we eat some of them and too bad for them. And that's a debate I'm not getting into. What I'm saying is proportionally our brain has functionalities that we take as human beings to be very important to our survival and adaptivity to situations. So one area is the thalamus. So I'm gonna point you to some specific areas, not all of them by any stretch will we cover. The brain is full of structures, and when we're talking about structures, what we're really talking about is neurons located in different areas. They're all neurons, but there's different kinds of neurons, right? And they have different functions, and their location seems to be important, or at least the development of where they are located seems to have functionality. So all sensory input but smell is integrated and sorted, so you could kind of look at that as a junction box, right? You got everything but smell. Why not smell? Because smell's right here in your brain anyway. All right, but sight goes through it because sight has to be rerouted. Touch, sound. So those activate various areas of your brain, and they're also routed to other areas of your brain. The reason you can hear sound as more than just a tone or noise and discriminate in this case is good. We're talking about stimulus discrimination, not social discrimination, which is bad. We're talking about being able to understand that a sound is a tone versus a word, taking a word to a poem versus a memo, understanding different languages. That's because it's routed, this information is routed to different areas of your brain through the use of interneurons. Hypothalamus got him a little asterisk beside him. Hypothalamus is a pea-sized gland below the thalamus. Hypothalamus. Thalamus, hypothalamus. Look, I even put the hypothalamus right below the thalamus. Wasn't that thoughtful of me? Help you remember that. Pea-sized gland below the thalamus controls basic biological needs. How are you going to remember that? The four Fs. Fighting, fleeing, feeding, and reproduction. All part of the limbic system. Right, so it turns out that this little tiny pea-sized gland is critical for our functioning and continuation as a species. As an individual, you got to go if you're threatened, or you got to fight if you're threatened. But as an individual collectively, we need to make more of us, right? So reproduction has to be partly biological. Humans have a lot more choice in mating than other species do, right? We have a lot of control. Some of us don't exercise control and engage in horrific kinds of behaviors that are socially inappropriate. But we have more control if we decide to exercise it than almost every other animal on the planet. Y'all have a wonderful day. We'll finish this up on Wednesday. I wanted to emphasize, somebody had a really good question after class, and I appreciate those. If you feel empowered, ask during class. I can make those clarifications. But if you ask after class, I'll be happy to clarify for the class, because if you got a question, likely somebody else does. And if this is review for you, good. Extra review is what helps you do well on a test. So your central nervous system is your brain and your spinal cord, right? CNS. And your peripheral nervous system is all of that which is outside of it, your PNS. Which I thought was a catchy little thing to help you remember it, right? So your peripheral nervous system and your central nervous system are actually integrated. They have separate functions, but clearly they cannot be independent of each other. So when we broke down the peripheral nervous system, we're talking about divisions that also overlap a little bit, but for the point of view of the test and understanding the systems, the divisions are very helpful. Somatic is where you have voluntary control over functions of your body. Autonomic, I liken to automatic because it works without your conscious awareness. It keeps you alive, keeps you breathing, keeps your heart beating, keeps you digesting food, keeps your metabolism going. And usually the system, subsystem that's in charge of all that is the parasympathetic system. It's kind of sympathetic, keeps you going. You face a threat in your environment, whether it's real physical threat, you think you might be hurt or killed, car crash, assault, military operations, some kind of natural disaster, tornado, hurricane, earthquake like in South Carolina, you're going to get a shot of adrenaline. A fight or flight response will occur. And internally, psychologically, if you perceive a threat that's not external, it could be a fear of being embarrassed, a fear of being rejected, a fear of feeling like you feel, you could get an adrenaline response too because your brain's perceiving it as though it is a legitimate threat and it's going to flood you with adrenaline and glucocorticoids. Sympathetic nervous system is going to take care of you at that moment. So moving on forward, I think that'll help us tie us together. If we look a little bit more at the parasympathetic, you don't need to know this for your test. Parasympathetic, we got slowing your heartbeat to what it is normally, your baseline heartbeat. You got flow of saliva, which you need to keep your mouth lubricated so you can masticate and chew food and not choke to death on it. Constricts your bronchi, stimulates your peristalsis, and that's what we're talking about before, digestion, moving the poo through the system, right? Stimulate and release of bile, contracts the bladder, all of that stuff. There's a link that's clogging this up. There we go. And the sympathetic, when you need it, you're going to get a shot of adrenaline and other glucocorticoids, dilating your pupils, inhibiting flow of saliva, accelerating your heart rate. Why do you dilate your pupils? Take in more light, but more of a tunnel vision experience because you're focusing in on why it might be threatening you, right? And you don't need to have a lot of saliva flow, so we shut that off. Accelerate your heartbeat so you can get more oxygen more quickly to the muscles. Dilate your bronchi so you can take in more oxygen. Inhibits peristalsis and secretions in the intestines because you don't need to be digesting food right now. In fact, you might even feel sort of a butterfly in the stomach sensation, right, as you get that shut down. Converting glycogen to glucose, secreting adrenaline and noradrenaline. And somebody else had a question about that adrenaline. That's epinephrine is another name for it, right? Epinephrine, norepinephrine. Adrenaline, noradrenaline. Same stuff. Inhibits bladder contraction, and that allows you to focus in on dealing with the threat for a short period of time. You'll be tweaked out, ready to fight. Or to flight, run away, or fight as hard as you can. But as soon as the threat's passed, the parasympathetic will take back over control and return you to baseline automatic functioning so that you breathe and you digest and all that other important stuff. So we talked about the central nervous system. I was just going to point you back at this. We've already covered this, so I'm not going to hang on it too long. You got your hindbrain that we share with reptiles. We got our midbrain, and we got our forebrain. That's a large section, many parts. We got our thalamus, and we got our hypothalamus with our four Fs, which are really absolutely essential to survival and procreation. That's what we're talking about right there, right? To survive, you have to eat, right? So feeding is important. You have to fight if you are, or flee if you're faced with a threat. And you have to engage in reproduction to regenerate a species. So we all have these biological drives within us. You don't go, I don't think I'll be hungry today. You are hungry because that's an automatic natural reaction. Those kind of things are monitored by the hypothalamus. And then we had the limbic system that we started to talk about. I believe we got stopped about right there. Separate but connected structures throughout the brain which help regulate memory. They also help regulate emotion. They also help regulate arousal and thus motivation. So there's multiple structures in the brain, but you now know with inner neurons, these are connected to one another. So they have neurons originating within these sections that project out into other sections that they are related to in terms of function, and they communicate with one another, and they do so fast that you can't even perceive it. It just feels like it's automatic, but it isn't. There's a process that goes on internally that can be inhibited by drugs, can be inhibited by damage to the tissue, either through an external insult to the brain, like a crash or a blow to the head or a fall, or an internal insult, which would be something along the lines of a stroke causing lesions or tumors growing and pressing on areas of the brain. All those areas have to be in their ideal shape to function well and integrate with one another. So this limbic system, we have the hippocampus, which we'll talk more about when we get in a chapter on memory, helping us with formations of new memories. So if you've seen that movie, 50 First Dates, where the Drew Barrymore character can't remember meeting the Adam Sandler character, it just looks crazy. Like, that's not real. Yeah, it can be real. It depends. It would be hard to sustain a deep brain injury like that, but if you broke a blood vessel, you certainly could. If you had a stroke, you certainly could. If you had a lesion in terms of a tumor pressing on and killing off that tissue, you certainly could. And if you don't have a hippocampus, you don't remember anything new. It's required for us to form new memories. We just do that all day, every day, so we don't put our minds to what's going on. And that's where I say practical significance. You're not going to run into hippocampal damage much in your life or in the lives of your families and friends, thank goodness. But when you're thinking about your ability to remember things, you're talking about the hippocampus and forming new memories. And stress, prolonged chronic stress and prolonged chronic anxiety can actually inhibit that, because you can get neuronal death in the hippocampal region from chronic exposure to glucocorticoids. And that is something we would talk about in that anxiety and stress seminar. The amygdala facilitates learning fear responses. When we get into the learning chapter, one of the most important chapters from my point of view, you're going to start looking at classical conditioning. And looking at learning there, we start to see mechanisms that facilitate learning or inhibit learning, which we'll talk about in the memory chapter. But when you have a fearful experience, when you have sickness, pain, or fear, you only need one time to be exposed to the stimuli to learn to avoid them, right? You get instant learning. Most things you got to expose yourself to time and time again, or do time and time again. When you're studying for a test, it helps if you will do that time and time again, right? It is work to acquire this information and remember it. But how many times do you have to touch a hot stove to learn that information? One time. And it creates an enduring memory that seems to be facilitated by the amygdala. So when we have those powerful negative emotional experiences, we get a thing called flashbulb memory sometimes, where you have a pretty vivid recollection of what occurred at the moment that trauma happened to you. Then we got the self-stimulation centers, the pleasure centers, where animal subjects, and this is looking at ESB, electrical stimulation of the brain, animal subjects will continually stimulate this area of their brain, if at all possible. It seems to be heavily involved with dopamine regulation, which I said the other day, technically, the only thing you enjoy is dopamine and serotonin. Those are the neurotransmitters most centrally involved with pleasure, although other ones are involved. And the area of the brain that seems to be centered in is what we call a self-stimulation center. Why is it called that? Because what we would see with animal models using rats and surgically implanting little electrode into that area of their brain, connecting it to a lever, they would press that lever and woo! To have them a little mental orgasm. Y'all know why people do cocaine and things like that? Because when they do it, they go, woo! They have them a little mental orgasm. They just lights them up, right? And it's the same area of the brain involved. It's the same area of the brain involved. So what you would see was a little rat would push that lever and push that lever and push that lever to the exclusion of eating until it got so exhausted it would just pass out and sleep. And as soon as it got back up, it was right back to pushing that lever. Animal model of addiction, right? What you see is the analog in humans is the use of certain psychoactive substances that produce that really intense high or really intense pleasure has a high potential for addiction. Now, when we get into the learning chapter, we'll see how that wanes over time and it's replaced by other processes that have implications for why treatment of addictions is so damn difficult. Because it's not just people's willpower. If it was, people would get better. Because most people who are addicted, losing their families, losing their jobs, losing their self-esteem, and all that other stuff, are not enjoying that ride. They would like to change it if they could. So it's an easy kind of thing that, oh, well, they just don't want to be different. That's not exactly the case.